There was a time, not so long ago, when had you stood anywhere along the banks of the Thames, or indeed even far inland at some remote marshland creek, you'd have been able to see, sails billowing in the wind, an old weather-beaten flat-bottomed sailing barge, easing its majestic way, laden down almost to its waterline with some cargo, bound on the tide upstream to some sleeping Essex village deep within the marshes. Under its somewhat dirty sails would be a crew of two, an old man and a boy, both members of a community apart, and both proud to be bargemen, for whom the river was a way of life.
It was born in them, you see. I mean, we always used to reckon bargemen was born to it, you know. You didn't sort of become a bargeman, you was mostly born to it from family, you know. You went from generation to generation to generation if you stuck it out, you know.
As a boy, Ken Horner did just that, sailing on the high tides out of Lee Creek with old men, whose feel for the river and her ways was, he maintains, almost instinctive.
They was a generation long gone. I mean, you take me for the war, from 16 to 20, 21, with sailing with old men at 60, 65, 70. They'd never know nothing else. I mean, they could read the weather. They could read the weather as they went along. Half of them couldn't really read nor write. Never used to worry about compasses or basically, no, not them. Charts. They feel their way around. Bargemen used to feel their way around mostly with a lead line, you know. Hand lead. Keep sound. All the time he could feel water, he knew where he was, you know. And how dark or how thick it was, they'd plumb the old lead. Oh, well, how much you got, Ken? Oh, five fathom. All right, you're all right. We shall come into about three, and then we'll go around. And sure, like you would, you couldn't see a thing. But you'd come down to 3 fathom, round you go and you'd stand off into the sea again and all that sort of thing, you know. It was done basically on knowledge, you know, and on local knowledge. In a fog they'd know where they was up to a point, you know, by sounding. It was a funny thing, because I mean, they used to go places where they hadn't been for hundreds of years, as I was, you know. I mean, perhaps, I mean, some of the skippers hadn't done a trip to a certain area not since he was a boy, but he would remember it, you know. He hadn't got a chart. I mean, they couldn't read nor write. I mean, half of them couldn't really read their name. Some of them used to sign their name with an X. You know, some of the old boys I went with. But they could find their way about. It's instinct, a lot of it, you know.
They were the most sophisticated and ingenious sailing craft ever developed. These craft were developed until they could take 150 tons up a remote little farm creek or across the North Sea to Holland or down channel to Cornwall or round the Land's End. Some of them would work back and forth to London with malt, and then they would suddenly be told that Guinness's brewery wanted a freight from Ipswich, and they would go away from, make a freight to Dublin. With a crew of ultimately a man and a boy. This is, it was always said that they were the only craft that would take 150 tons to sea with a crew of a man and a boy, and yet they'd float wherever there'd been a heavy dew.
If you look at a map of Essex, you'll see that Essex is virtually an island. It has the Lee and the Roding up on the west side, and then you've got the Thames on the south, and then the sea on the east, and then the north, of course, you've got the Orwell and the Stour, and you've got Birchill Island, but of course there's loads and loads of creeks in and out of the county itself. This required a vessel that could get up these creeks. They were strong tidal, and of course most of them dried out. So it had to be a shallow draft vessel carrying the maximum load, and minimum number of crew because of the economics of the whole thing, and the ability to sort of sit down on the mud without laying over on its side, as most coasting vessels did, lay right over. So of course a long oblong box sort of comes to mind when you think of those requirements. And the barge is virtually this, except with refinements to help them to maintain a course to windward. And they've got this ability, they're flat bottom, they've got this ability to sit on the mud. But they've got the long oblong box, got the ends sharpened up a bit in order to get through the water. And over the years it developed to quite a fine, handy sort of craft, and it's amazing what can be done. The big boards on the sides have worried some people. They thought they were wings and they spread them out to stop the thing going over. But actually, they're referred to as lee boards, and these were the lee board, that's the one away from the wind, was lowered in order to stop the barge skating sideways. It acted rather like the centre board in a modern dinghy. They're lowered to stop the boat skating sideways when they work in the windward. And of course, at sea, they raised and lowered one alternate lee boards on either side, depending on which tack they were on. And this helped the barge up to windward. And they could sail quite close to the wind, and a half-loaded barge could really go in a fair old breeze. They did make some quite smart passages.
I would say our graph, summer and winter. Winter, you've got the hard conditions at sea, you know, night after night, day after day. In the summer, it could be hard work. When there wasn't so much wind, you know, you did a fair amount of rowing them, you know, to get them out of trouble in the river. I mean, other than that, it was anchor drill in fine weather, you know.